Welcome back to A2PC. Today we've got section 11.2, evaluating limits. And you could have the little footnote here that this is algebraically. We already talked about in the last section how we can use a calculator and like that trace feature with Zoombox, how that can really help us use technology to help us make a very good, approximation of what a limit is, but there are algebraic techniques that will help us handle that as well. I do have a pun for this one too. Here we have Dr. Evil from Austin Powers, and he's sitting in a waiting room. So this is Evil waiting, and I think he's at his limit. It looks like he's not very patient anymore. All right, so the first thing that we want to do if we're trying to evaluate a limit algebraically is, first of all, try direct substitution. The only issue for now is that 0 over 0 case. It's called an indeterminate form, and that's something that we saw in the last section when we used our calculators, but now we're going to talk about how algebraically we can sidestep this 0 over 0 case. Okay, now factoring. This is with the intent to cancel. When we have a 0 over 0 case show up, it usually means that we had factors that can be canceled out, and then we can have something that will allow us to substitute. So realize that factoring, this could be anything from difference of squares, sum or difference of cubes. We could also use some long and synthetic division to help factor up a polynomial if it has a much higher degree, and we're seeing that somewhere in the fraction show up. We also use conjugates. This is typically what we would use if we notice like square roots. Common denominators if we have complex fractions. Okay, and we hoped we'd never have to encounter it again, but trigonometric identities can prove to be a big asset to us if we do have trig functions involved. Sometimes that's what it takes. Again, the entire goal of these is to get the problem to cancel out. Whatever is causing this 0 over 0, can we algebraically get that to cancel out? Now, a lot of these, it looks like a long list, and this is a lot of the algebra that we did first semester, and it is quite a long list, but I think you'll see that when you see these functions show up, a lot of what you would intuitively try to do is the right technique. So again, a lot of it's just what you would expect. If I were just to turn you loose, you'd probably have this cross your mind at some point. But the biggest thing is we're trying to get a factor to cancel. And sometimes that requires these other techniques, but it all does boil down to getting a factor that cancels. All right, so we've got a few examples today because there's a lot of different techniques that could be employed. So for number 18, first we're going to try direct substitution. If I plug in a negative 4 for my variable a, this should say a approaches negative 4. A to the third would be negative 64. And then my denominator would be a negative 4 plus 4. So sure enough, that is a 0 over 0. But that also tells me there must be a way to get this a plus 4 to cancel out. If ultimately I end up with a 0 in my numerator, it means somewhere along the line, this factor had to emerge. So let's rewrite our limit, the limit as a approaches negative 4. And this numerator can be factored. It's a sum of two things that are perfect cubes. This is really a to the third plus 4 to the third. So to factor that out, I take that expression just without the third power, so it's just an a plus 4. First times first, had to make a to the third. I wanted the middle to cancel out, so I need a minus 4 times a. And then my last times last has to make 64 positive, so 4 and 16 will do that. Then my denominator, take a look, that is the quantity a plus 4 grouped by the fraction down there. So sure enough, we were able to cancel out that problematic a plus 4 factor. That's what was giving me that 0 over 0 all along. All right, so where are we at now? You'll notice that I keep writing limit. That is essential. We will always write LIM, as much of a pain in the butt as that is. Your cursive for these three letters will be beautiful, I guarantee that. But we do not take that away until we are at a point where we can actually substitute in, and that is right now. So we would need to write this down. It's real easy to just copy down the expression inside, but we do need to have that. That's important notation. So now if I substitute in a negative 4, I get negative 4 to the second minus 4 times 4. Negative 4 times negative 4, so it's a positive 16 plus another 16, we get 48. And if we were to check that in a calculator or something like that, we could definitely confirm with a graph, though you may want to use like a Desmos or a GeoGebra to graph something like this a little bit more quickly. So technique number one, factoring. Number 22, this one has a really neat little, I don't want to call it a shortcut, but it's kind of like a way of manipulating the process to be a little bit faster, because these four-term cubics, really the only way we have to factor a four-term cubic is factor by grouping, which is kind of labor-intensive. So let's start with direct substitution. Maybe we don't even have to do that. So if I directly substitute in a negative 3, let's see what my limit looks like. I would have a negative 27, and then 2 times 9, that's plus 18. Negative 9 times negative 3, there's a plus 27, and then we end with a minus 18. So sure enough, my numerator is going to be a 0. My denominator, negative 27, and then a positive 9, and then a positive 27, and a negative 9, yep. Not really surprised that we got 0 over 0. But here's where the neat shortcut takes place. I know that because as x got close to a negative 3, when I tried to plug in a negative 3, that's what caused this 0 over 0. That means that in this limit, there had to be an x plus 3 factor in the top and the bottom. There had to be, otherwise we would not get 0 over 0. So the shortcut is, I can look at the numerator and the denominator, and I can just try and make the FOIL match up. So I started off in my numerator with an x to the third. I've got x times something. First times first had to make x to the third. This has to be x squared. Last is a positive 3 times last over here had to make a negative 18. So this has to be a negative 6. Okay, and then for the inside, just make your x squares add up. So right now I've got 3 times x squared. That's 3x squared. And I want to end up with 2x squared. So that means when I do x here times something x here, I want that to be a negative 1x squared, so minus 1x. See how that makes the 3x squared minus 1x squared? And then we're set. If I take a look at my x's, maybe I don't trust this. I can always check with this x term here. 3 times negative x, that's negative 3x. X times negative 6, there's negative 6. Negative 3 and negative 6 make the negative 9 that we had. So it makes these types of factoring problems much faster than grouping, especially after you've done a couple and you know what to look for. First times first, let's try the denominator. That'll make my x to the third. Last times last, that'll make my negative 9 that I had up here. And then I've got plus 3x squared. I want to end up with only plus 1, so this has to be a minus 2x. Plus 3x squared. Minus 2x squared. If we just think through the distribution and we keep an eye on our target up here, we can factor that pretty quickly. Okay, but more importantly, we got that problem canceled out. That x plus 3 factor that was kind of ruining our polynomial, we got that completely wiped out. Now you can, now that we've got quadratics that are left behind, let's take a look at what our limit is now. I'm kind of going Christmas theme, unintentional. I've got x squared minus x minus 6 over x squared minus 2x minus 3. Maybe you go nuts and say, hey, I'm pretty good at factoring quadratics. You're welcome to factor this out further and see if something else cancels. So this would have to be an x minus 3 and an x plus 2. And then in my denominator, I'd have to have an x minus 3 and an x plus 1. Hey, we actually did get something else to cancel. I haven't substituted in my negative 3 yet, but I have given myself a much easier function to substitute into. So while this step is unnecessary, once we get rid of the problem, you're welcome to substitute in and be done with it. But there could be some other factoring there that helps you out. So I'd encourage you to look for that. We're at the place where we can substitute in our negative 3. Negative 3 plus 2 in my numerator, negative 3 plus 1 in my denominator, that limit is 1/2. And again, if we have doubts about our algebra, we can go back and check with a calculator. But really, really good review for algebra. Definitely something that absolutely helps us out. Number 26, oh man, square root. Well, let's try our direct substitution first. So 4 minus the square root of 18 minus 2, that's 16. Oh man, the square root of 16 is 4, so that's 4 minus 4 really happening up there. That's a 0. And then my denominator, I would have replaced the x with a 2. It's really 2 minus 2 down there. I know, I didn't surprise a single person watching, but we got 0 over 0. Okay, so what can we do with this function when I've got to try and get a factor of x minus 2 to cancel out? So I'm hoping I can wipe out this denominator. That's what really caused the issue. If I had 0 over 7, that wouldn't be a problem. The answer would just be 0, but that 0 denominator, man, if I can cancel that out, I'm set. So we've got a conjugate scenario here. That's how we handle square roots. So let's see here. My numerator is 4 minus some square root. Its conjugate would be 4 plus that same square root, as nasty as it is. And when I multiply by a conjugate, I'm adjusting the fraction, so I have to also multiply that into the denominator. That way I'm really just multiplying by 1, something divided by itself. It's just a very nasty way of expressing that 1. Okay, so the limit as x approaches 2. In my numerator, I've set up a set of difference of perfect square factors. So I would have the first times first, and then the second thing times itself is just going to wipe out the square root. So it's minus the quantity 18 minus x. We canceled out the square root. In my denominator, and this is crucial, don't you dare FOIL. We have this lovely factor that we were hoping to cancel. Leave it factored out. That other quantity can be a square root. We'll handle that in just a second. But I want to leave this factor here so that it can be easily canceled. In my numerator now, since I no longer have a square root issue, I'm going to go ahead and distribute. A distributing negative is the bane of even some of the most accomplished math students. So I've got a 16 and then minus 18, and I've got a negative, negative x. And although they're not in the desired order, look at my numerator. It's a negative 2 with a positive x. That is the same factor, the same terms as x minus 2, that factor we had in the denominator. We managed to cancel that out perfectly. I have not substituted in yet, so I need limit as x approaches 2. And now I'm left with this. You can see we got the problem to cancel out. That's beautiful. So we're ready to directly substitute in. I know my numerator is going to be a 1. 4 plus the square root of 18 minus 2, that's 4 plus the square root of 16. My answer is 1 over 8. All right, these problems take some time. You know, what a great review of a lot of the algebra techniques that we covered early in the year. The folks that laid out our textbook, you know, putting this type of algebra later on in the textbook is just a wonderful, wonderful thing, which is easy for me as the teacher to say. I know it's not probably as delightful for you as the student to hear that, but trust me, this is making you a much stronger math student by revisiting this algebra. These are the concepts that plague a lot of students in calculus, so if we can brush up on those now, it's only going to help us. Number 28, if I substitute in a value of 0, let's see, I've got 1 over negative 8 plus 1 over 8 all over 0. Yep, it's a 0 over 0. Okay, well, our limit as x approaches 0 then. Let's see what we can do with common denominators. So I would like to set up common denominators with these two fractions in my numerator, that way I can just multiply by the reciprocal to divide by this x over 1 that I'm seeing in my denominator. So to make that adjustment, I need a factor of 8 in my first fraction and a factor of x minus 8 in my second fraction. So kind of like last time, I'm going to multiply those into top and bottom. And that way I will set up 8 times the quantity x minus 8 as a common denominator. So here's my big divide. Everything's happening over x. I've got 8 times 1. And I've got a common denominator. And then I've got plus 1 times this quantity. So plus 1 times x and 1 times negative 8. I really want to be careful of distributing negatives here. That's an easy place to miss them. So I might just want to even leave that as the quantity, plus all of this. All right. And let's see what we can do with that. So in my numerator, I can tidy up, combine some like terms there. I've got, well, just an x. Then I've got my common denominator. And then all of that was being divided by x. So that's like multiplying by the reciprocal 1 over x to do that huge division. And as you can see, we've got an x in the numerator and a factor of x multiplied into the denominator. Those will cancel. So my limit is really 1 over 8 times x minus 8. And now I'm able to substitute in this 0. It's an 8 times a negative 8 down there. This is 1 over 64 negative. Negative 1/64. Work like this is so satisfying. There's something that's very gratifying about getting factors to cancel and drawing those slashes in all victoriously and stuff. That's a good feeling in math. And this section is one that is just littered with that. So I'm having a lot of fun here. All right. Now we've got some trig. Oh man, trig. Let's see what happens when we substitute in a 0. Well, the cosine at 0 is 1 minus 1 over the sine at 0 is 0. Yeah, there's a surprise, 0 over 0. So we're indeterminate. And you can see we don't have a lot of options. There's not like a conjugate. There's not a common denominator. There's no factoring to do here. We need a trig identity. And I'd love to cancel out this problematic sine of x if I could. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to multiply in top and bottom. I'm going to multiply in sine x. Now my limit as x approaches 0 has sine of x times cosine x minus 1 over sine squared x. And because of Pythagorean identity, sine squared is 1 minus cosine squared. And now with a little bit of algebra, we can factor that 1 minus cosine squared as a difference of squares, 1 plus cosine x and 1 minus cosine x. And we're really, really close. These factors here on the end are really close to canceling. And as we saw earlier, cosine of x minus 1, that was producing a 0. So this is really a chance to cancel out the problem for us. The only issue is that here I've got a cosine that's positive and a 1 that's negative, and that switches in my factor that's in my denominator. So I'm going to GCF, just take a greatest common factor of negative 1 out of the top, and it's just going to be out of this factor of the top. So I would have a negative cosine of x and a positive 1, and I just freed that negative 1. I just wrote that out in front of the sine x. I don't want to lose it. And now we've got a positive 1 with a negative cosine, just like that factor in the denominator. So my limit as x approaches 0 is really a negative sine x over a 1 plus cosine x. Let's see what happens. When I directly substitute in a 0, now I've got negative sine of x, which is still 0. And then in the denominator, though, I've got 1 plus cosine x. And cosine at 0 is a 1. So this is 1 plus 1 down here. It's 2. So my actual answer is 0. Sometimes when we see a 0 show up anywhere, we can be inclined to believe that we screwed something up or that we have to do more work or anything like that, remember, it's only 0 over 0. 0 divided by 2 is something that we can calculate. It is 0, and that's a possible answer here. And it is our answer here. And again, if we had any doubts, we could always turn to the calculator to verify that or back it up. All right, now lastly, this is going to be big. And I'm not saying big as in a lot of writing, even though that's true. This concept right here is something that's called a difference quotient. And it's something that we're going to explore a lot more in section 11.3. But for our purposes here, it fits beautifully. And this algebra is something that you will see a lot in your first chapter of calculus work. So this is something that we definitely want to familiarize ourselves with. It leads into what I would call maybe the first third of calculus, which is the derivative. So this is the cornerstone of your derivative work in calculus. All right, I'm going to try and color code this as best I can. We've got this variable h that shows up, and that's just an arbitrary distance. It's just some value in here that's approaching 0. And then in red, the first thing I need to do is I need to figure out what's f if I substitute in an x plus h wherever I see an x. So, okay, I've got 4 minus not 2x, but 2 times x plus h. Minus not x, but x plus h squared. Okay, then minus, that's the difference part. We've got just f of x, just how we see it here. Just be very, very careful about distributing negatives. So definitely group that. Here is my f of x. All of that is being subtracted away. And here's the quotient. That's all over h. Now, perfectly in keeping with this section, the problem is if I were to substitute in an h value of 0, all these terms in the numerator would cancel out. So directly substituting in now, this value of 0, it would just be 0 over 0 for a final result. So we've got to find a way to cancel out that h in the denominator. Well, let's take a second and expand out, see what happens in our numerator. I've got a 4 and then a negative 2x and then a negative 2h, a little distribution. And this we want to be careful. We've got to FOIL or expand this binomial and then distribute a negative into that as well. So you can do that off to the side. It's a negative x squared, then a negative 2xh, and then a negative h to the second. And then we've got a distributing negative into all of our green terms here. Minus 4 plus 2x plus x squared. And that's still all over that h, the problematic h. Now, if I've done my work correctly here, and this is a great opportunity to check before you're too far into this thing, as I combine the like terms in my numerator, anything that does not have an h should cancel out. So let's see, I had a positive 4 and a negative 4. I had a negative 2x and a positive 2x. I had a negative x squared and a positive x squared. So all of those cancel. So we have canceled terms when we combine the like terms together. We want to write a separate step. We never cancel terms and factors in the same step. As tempting as it is, you can probably start to see where this is headed right now. But I notice that all the terms that are left in my numerator have h in them somehow. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a greatest common factor of h out of all those terms just in my numerator. So I take the h away from this term, it's just a negative 2. Take the h away from this term, it's a negative 2x. And I take an h away from this h squared, that's a minus h. And now we get this step where we can see very clearly that h is multiplied into the numerator. And that division of the fraction will cancel out h now. The problem is gone. The limit as h approaches 0, now the expression inside is a negative 2 minus 2x minus h, and we're able to directly substitute in this value of 0 just for h, not x, and I get the expression negative 2 minus 2x. And what we'll talk about in section 11.3 is that this result right here is what's known as the derivative of f of x. It's a new function that tells us something about f, and I'll save that for the next section. Here's a look at your assignment. Pay special attention to 67 to 73. There's a lot of great algebra in this. This is one of those sections that when I look at your homework, I'll be able to very instantly tell if you got quality practice out of this or not. So definitely, this is an ease off the accelerator a little bit section. We want to make sure we understand the algebra, because this is algebra that if you do not understand it well now and do not brush up on it now, it will come back to haunt you. That's not just an empty threat. I'm just trying to brace you for success here. That does it for section 11.2. On that positive note, I hope you've enjoyed it. This has been a lot of fun.